My name is Vaichit, sales part of Elite Mastermind Group. Go ahead and introduce yourself to everybody. Let us know which part of the world you're tuning in from.
Okay, I'm Anne-Marie Barber, and I am tuning in from Baltimore, Maryland. If you don't know Baltimore, we're about 3 hours from New York, about an hour from Washington, D.C.
Awesome. On the other side of the Mississippi River. So when we divide the country, if you're in L.A., we divide the country in half.
That's right.
And we see everybody's on that side. It's much easier versus looking at it on the map. But you must be in a nice place. So here's my questions for you.
Yes.
Your page is fantastic. I love the videos. I love the IGTVs that you put on. Definitely a lot of time is being put on that. So whoever is doing that, if you ever fire them, let them know I have a job for them.
Okay. She's great. Her name's Jessica, and she's great. She's great.
Okay. I need to be in touch with Jessica because I'm kind of jealous because your page has got a little bit more. I need to talk to Jessica, so put me in contact with Jessica for sure.
Will do. Will do.
I have a question.
Yes.
A lot of individuals that are in fitness have told me in the past that I was wrong, that I thought fitness had to do with exercise and eating, but then they correct me saying that the mindset is way more important than those other two factors. Obviously, they're important, but having the right mindset is important. As entrepreneurs, how do we utilize that mindset in our business?
Yeah. You know, it's funny because if you think of a lot of big companies, big business, who do they like to hire a lot of the times are elite athletes, collegiate athletes, professional athletes, because their mindset, yes, it's the physical, but it is also the mindset. So I have a son that's a Division I runner, and, you know, that focus is going to help him in the long run. And it's not just being fit or moving your body. I think that's part of fitness. And that's really important for physical health, for your heart health, you know, to move, you know, your joint, to do yoga, to have kind of a 360 approach to exercise. So you've got the flexibility, you have the strength, you have the agility. I think that's all important.
But listen, some of those yoga positions, I don't even think that they're possible. Like if you're a female, 120 pounds, maybe.
But hey, you'd be
for
surprised.
A big guy like me, when I see some of those moves, I'm getting hurt. Like I'm looking, I'm like, I don't know. That's just my opinion. I don't know. Because some of them just look weird. I'm like, was the human body made to do that? Like, was that, I mean, was that my intention? Because they look weird.
Yeah, exactly. It's hard. It is. But I think if you work at it and you practice it, like everything's a practice. And I've been hearing, I've watched a couple of your, you know, your former guests, and they're, you know, it's about whether they're practicing their mind or what their morning routine is. You know, the same thing with yoga. You stick with it. You can go deeper and it's your practice. You're not comparing yourself to anybody else. That is your time on your mat. Just like your last guest was like, I get into the office and I'm focused. That's his time to focus at work. You focus on the mat. So just to go back to your question, I think the mentally, that movement is important. And we're seeing that more so now with COVID-19 and being at home. Because there is a lot of depression and there are people that are overeating and it's very hard for people to, you know, take care of themselves because they're used to this outside help. But we can get it virtually like we're doing now. You can get it, you know, in that live streaming space with your gym or your studio or your nutritionist or your personal trainer. But it's also your mindset and where you are in your head to, you know, get it straight and get it right and really focus on the whole body from mind, you know, the whole mind-body connection.
So here's my question. Why is it that all these football players and basketball players, why are they're all not multi-millionaires when they leave their profession after 4 or 5 years? It feels like the trend is more like the income declines and the total asset goes out. If they have that kind of mindset, is it like because they don't know what to do with their money? Is it because they don't have the business side? I mean, that's been a question to me all the time because you look at them and you're like, man, this guy's on top. Like, they're the elite group. If you get part of, I mean, if you're part of a basketball team, NFL team, like, you have to do a lot of work. It's not easy to get there. I know they make it look easy. You see the videos and everything else, but it's not easy. It's like a big 10, 15 years worth of a lot of hard work. So what kind of mindset can we have from that? Maybe they can learn from non-fit entrepreneurs about their
Sure. Yeah. I think it goes both ways. I think, you know, not everybody is going to be that entrepreneur when they leave the NFL. You know, not every, you know, you've seen the supermodels that were gorgeous just walking up and down the catwalk. And those like Tyra Banks or Heidi Klum, you know, really created empires. Or you look at the actress Gwyneth Paltrow. She was a great actress. Yeah, she was told what to do by the director, reading what the writer wrote. Very talented in that aspect. But look what she did in addition to her acting career. Or the Jenner, or Kylie, not Jenner, but the Kardashians. You know, yes, they're famous, but what some of them have done, you know, to expand I'm sorry, I have some noise going on in the background. But
well, do they want to join the live session?
Yeah.
Do they want to join?
Yeah, they're good. They're good. We're good. It's quiet now. But you know what I'm saying? It's like, yeah, you've got one talent and you could be so good at it. You could be that marathon runner that, you know, finishes in 3 hours or 2 hours or 1.5 hours. And then, you know, everything else, that's, you know, you're just kind of like a one note. So that's a really good point. A lot of it is here and focus and knowing what you want to do and going after it. Yeah, for sure. That's a good point.
As a coach, as an influencer, as someone who coaches other individuals, what are some of the routines or what are some of the success principles that have helped you so far personally to get to this level?
Yes, I think having a plan the night before really helps me. Like especially for my workout, like I'm going to work out from, you know, 7:30 to 8:30. I'm going to make that shake. I'm going to journal in the morning. You know, this is going to be my morning. And then my morning sets me up for the rest of the day. So that's, you know, where I get in the morning and then I get into that rhythm. My morning sets my tone. And then the rest of the day, I stay very focused. And it's hard. I mean, I've been doing a lot of work. So before I'm starting a club, and I'll tell you what I'm doing, but my prior business, I started, ran it for 10 years with my best friend from high school, my business partner. We created group fitness programming in Ballet Bar, if your guests know Bar Fitness. And what we saw is, you know, you know, when you start a business, you see a need, right? So we saw all these boutique studio, fitness boutique studios popping up from Orange Theories to Pure Bar to Soul Cycle. And they're on every street corner in New York City and in a lot of cities. And these bigger gyms, these big boxes, we call them, gyms were kind of losing their members to this more specialized, cool, immersive, you know, experience with these rock star instructors and great music, creating this vibe and like, you know, your vibe attracts your tribe, just kind of this cool experience. So what we thought is, well, why can't the big gyms have this same boutique experience? And we took Bar, because Bar, Ballet Bar, I don't know if you're familiar with it, like Physique 57 or Pure Bar or the Bar Method, had this really cool appeal. So we came to the gyms and said, listen, we're going to create this programming. We're going to train up your instructors. You're going to implement it. And you're now going to have that boutique experience for your members within the big box. And they call that kind of the club within the club. So I started that way. And that was a lot of choreography and creating and training instructors in our method. So what I loved about doing that for 10 years, we kind of got into it as creators, content creators, fitness creators. But then we realized there was a whole business, you know, there's bookkeeping, there's sales, there's social media, you know, everything that you're doing to promote, you know, your brand, you know, brand management and promotion. And we thought, oh my gosh, what did we just get ourselves into? But it was a great experience.
I want to shoot myself the amount of emails that I get. And the other day I was thinking, for every 30-minute session that I do, I got to spend 45 minutes emailing. I was like, it doesn't make sense. Like, just get on the live and then we'll talk.
No.
Like, I don't need to know the right. Like, just look at my face. Let's just talk, because that 45 minutes could be utilized, giving more value to other people. So I totally get how that works. But here's the question. Did you, at what point did you guys decide that there was a business or that we need to create this? Because that doesn't come naturally to people. A lot of times I'm looking at someone's activity, I'm like, that should be your business. They're like, nah, this is just what I do. I'm like, this is a business. Like, you should be
Sure.
treating it like a business. How did you
Sure.
know, and how did you guys figure that out?
Yeah, I think we just saw this incredible need for these big box gyms to compete. I mean, they were just losing members, and we just, when we started out teaching these programs in a gym, and then we were like, well, wait a minute, maybe we could create an actual program, an actual method. And there's so many great ones out there, like Les Mills or Zumba. If you look at them, they're creating, they have, that's all these people do is create this wonderful content set to music. They do top tier training, and then they in, put that training, into these gyms. And I was with Soulbody. My business partner is still running it. Check it out, Soulbody Global. I think it is
So how
on.
important is it for people, entrepreneurs, to be creative? Because I feel like a lot of times, because we give a shit what other people think about us, that level of creativity just
Sure.
keeps coming lower. So at what point did you say, we're not going to care about what anybody thinks and we're just going to do this? Or how do
Yeah.
you create that mindset?
Yeah, it's interesting because I'm working with a, now that I've left Soulbody, I'm working with two other teams. So, and that goes right with right in line. This guy Mike Hansen with Endorphins, and he's doing everything fitness streaming. He comes from a tech background, but kind of got into fitness and now is creating kind of the blueprint, as he calls it, to setting up a live a fitness streaming, whether it's video on demand or live stream. And you see it all over Instagram and Facebook now. With COVID, everyone's home. There's 1,000 instructors going live teaching fitness classes. So, the part that he talked about as a blueprint, I think is really important because you can have so many ideas. Like you said, oh, this idea could be a business or this business, but it even though it's a great idea, it sometimes is not successful because it's not executed right. It's not fueled. It's not marketed. It's not promoted. So, I see a lot of businesses that are just like, oh my gosh, what a great product. What a great service. What a great fitness class or what a great, app. And then nothing happens because it's not supported. There was not a blueprint. There was not that business plan. Like everyone's like, where's your business plan? Who's your team? You need that. And you
I
need
mean,
money and
I
you need
agree with that
money.
100% because I was watching a documentary unrelated to this topic, but it fits right in. I was watching Boeing 747 being built, and these massive engines, they put out so much power and everything else. And then during the documentary, they were saying how, in a cruising altitude, like they could just do it with one engine. They don't need all four. It could just cool. But in order to take
Yes.
off,
Yes. Yeah.
like they need these massive engines. Like it was like they put a number to it. It was like 70, 80% of the entire thrust, all of these different power, like the horsepower was like so astronomic number. I don't remember. But it was just like takeoff. And what you just said is like for the takeoff,
To wear
you need
that.
like an army pushing there. But
Yeah.
once you're in an altitude and you're cruising,
Yeah.
you might not need everybody to be
Right.
pushing. You
Right.
just everybody could be chilling a little bit. But just taking off.
That's a great analogy to business, actually, if you really think about it, to take off,
Oh,
get the support.
everybody
I mean, you
hands
need your
on deck, like
family. I
focus.
mean, yeah, you need all that support, that team, and then you've got that cruising altitude. But then you've got to be careful. I mean, just like with the landing, like then you got to be all into the landing. You're never cruising for too long because if you do, you're not
No,
gonna
you can't stagger it.
trans,
And
yeah.
here's the crazy part. A lot of fitness, I'm just comparing this to your industry. A lot of individuals that were in fitness that weren't on social media, now they're trying to catch up instead of them
Oh.
being the innovators because they were making fun of a lot of people that were on social media. I
Yeah.
mean, fitness on Instagram is kind of a little bit weird because it's like a modeling slash fitness. I wouldn't get a fat trainer that comes on Instagram that does all that training because I feel more related to them maybe a little bit because all of these guys are all I got the six
Oh.
pack the
Yeah.
chest. I'm
Yeah.
like, damn man, these they must be working on that for like too many years. Like there's too much gap in where I am and where they're at. So can you send a message to all the fitness people? Just say, you know, can we get like some fat
people? Everyday guy, the everyday guy. I think it's very the landscape has changed with fitness. It's more health, like you said. It's not just the ripped abs. And I think that's great. And you're right. Like those Instagram, you know, and a lot of people in the fitness industry talk about that. Like, okay, how many times are you going to take a picture of yourself in the mirror with those ripped abs? I think it's great, but you're not going to speak to a lot of people and you're not going to, you know, motivate. Well, maybe motivate, but maybe, you know, not be that, not inspire as well as you could if you kind of brought it down and spoke to people where they are on their level. I think that's really important.
What I love about what social media and this whole entire platforms are doing is that they're bringing a lot of awareness more about health than just fitness itself.
Yes.
I think it's a combination. And that goes with entrepreneurship. Everything. You are now able to find out what products should you buy. Yeah. You know, what do they contain? Because when I'm looking at some of these labels, it must be in Chinese because I don't understand half of this stuff that we're putting in our body. And I don't even know what they
are. That's right. Like,
they're labeled, but that doesn't do any good if I can't understand what they are. So I think I saw a fitness, I saw one of the guys that I follow, and I think he's in New York too. And I loved it. I was just glued to this live session. Let me translate these four items, what they are. And it was so educational. I was like, finally, somebody is telling me what is in this cereal. I'm breaking it down. They're like, this is good. This is not good, dude. I was like, this is my first time. I mean, you don't want to, I don't know. I'm one of those guys. I do have my own ego. I don't want to feel like I'm stupid. Like, I think I should know these things, right? If my daughter ever grows up and says, Daddy, what are these things? Like, that would be embarrassing. Like, I don't know nothing. I'm like, let me Google it. Let me find out. So I was getting totally schooled for my daughter. It was like totally cool. I loved it.
Yeah. Well, you know, I think about all the processed foods out there, just to go on the food rant for a second. And you go to the supermarket and all of the things that you can't read, those ingredients that are not good for you. And I think about, we just buy it. I mean, a lot of this processed food is made in a lab by scientists, not chefs. And we buy it and we eat it because it's at the store. And I always say, like, if you were walking down the streets of New York City and someone was like, oh, here, take this pill. And you were like, what's in it? Well, don't worry about it. Just take this pill. You would never take that pill. So it's like we're eating a lot of foods that we don't understand what's in it, and it's not healthy. And, you know, if there's five ingredients that says wheat flour, you know, garlic powder, you know, things that you understand, there's five ingredients, that's great. Or eating from the earth. I mean, a banana, a sweet potato, a potato, and not putting a ton of, you know, condiments on it. Like, we need to become more simple in our eating and just eat as close to as we can.
Sustainable. Keep in mind, we got about 7-8 billion people on this planet.
Yeah.
At some point, somebody needs to let everybody know that this, what we've been doing, is not sustainable. Like, we've cut down 75% of the trees on this planet. Like, that shit is not sustainable. Like, they don't grow every day 20 feet for you to be cutting. So to me, I think social media, within the next 10 years, we're going to see a lot changes. I was watching another live session, and this guy was in a different country, and he was showing all these manufacturing that's happening that are actually polluting our world.
Yeah, 100%.
What he said, that was so true. He said, if you are in U.S. and watching this, don't think this doesn't affect you. In about 5 to 7 years, this pollution will hit you in your country. There is a delay, but it will get to you because it's going in circles. So to me, it's like, I love social media because it's definitely helping. So how could people find you?
Okay, so Be Well Advisory or Annie Barbs, but go to Be Well Advisory. I'm blogging a lot. And I'm also writing for Endorphins, which is Endorphins with a Z. I'm their education lead. And then I have a big project coming up, but you'll have to stay tuned on Be Well. Based on COVID, not sure, but we're planning on building a really great boutique fitness and wellness club. Hope that happens.
Listen, thank you so much for taking this time out
of your busy day.
Hopefully we can do more.
Oh, I loved it. Thanks so much for having me.
You got it. Talk to you soon. Bye-bye.
Bye.